Ladies and gentlemen, we have today someone who is basically my father in drumming. You heard me talking about him so much on the site and all the lessons with the Jazz 101 series and everything. Everything I do, he's in my sound there somewhere. And the great Roy McCurdy.
Well, thank you, Phil.
It's such
thank
a great you. Honor to be able to
my
to
pleasure.
Do this, man.
My pleasure.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So let's do something personal just to start off with. Uh-huh. What did you think of me like the first time you saw me?
Oh, well, let me tell you something. I can't even remember back then.
I was 14
years
old.
He was a young kid, yeah. Man. He was a young kid.
I was 14 years old.
Yeah.
And, you know, I saw you play at a gig, and I sat right behind you. I was right behind the drums, man. And I was so, like, hypnotized, and it was so beautiful. It was like, wow. You know, that's the first time I really saw, like, an amazing drummer in my life, you know. That
right,
was,
right.
Before, it was just, you know. But that time, and it really hit me so strong. And so after that, I started to study with you, and I guess it was about a year or so.
Yeah.
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 You know, I was just a kid. I wish I would have had the.
Yeah, I remember, but I remember you caught on fast to everything. You know, it was really fast. It was really great. You know, I mean, it was. I mean, you were gone because after you started stopped studying with me, it was just a few years later, man, when I saw you. You know, doing things with your Latin things and all those kind of things, you know, which was, and I said, well, check Phil out.
Well, I tell you, the way you formed me in jazz really carried through the rest of my life, you know, that thing. And so maybe we can find out, like, what your concepts are, you know, directly from the source. Now, I've talked about things that I remember, but directly from the source is always great. So if you could just talk about a couple of things for us. First, there's how do you get that drive? You know, there's a certain drive that you have, like, that makes the music really flow and not be, even though sometimes it's, you know, easy going, it still has an amazing drive and power when you play. Do you have a concept for that?
Yeah, well, it's, you know, it came from, basically, it came from listening to a lot of guys, you know, listening to a lot of guys like Max Roach and Blakey and Philly Joe Jones, Art Taylor, all those kind of guys, Shelly, man, they all had a way of driving the band and pushing their quintets and things. And so I would listen to all these things and run back and try to play them, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So just playing them all the time, practicing that kind of thing, practice those different styles of play. You know, I kind of developed my own kind of thing to play with. And then it developed over the years from playing with guys like, you know, like playing with Sonny Rollins and Cannon Maloska, all those guys, you know.
Right.
And I think the first group I played, major group, was with Art Farmer. And it was a group called the Jazz Tet. And we played, they had a great book, and we played with a lot of drive, but it was still kind of light.
Right, right,
you know,
right.
It was kind of light way of playing, but still intense.
Right, right.
And, but it was kind of brought on to me when I was playing with Sonny. The first time I played with Sonny Rollins, the first gig, I was still playing like the light kind of intense way with, that I was playing with the Jazz Tet.
Uh-huh.
But Sonny needed more, you know? So the first gig we played there, he wrote me a letter. And he said, Roy McCurdy, he says,
wow.
Dear Roy, he said, this is Sonny Rollins. He says, I'm playing hard, playing my butt off, and you're playing too light.
Wow.
He says, please play harder, sincerely, Sonny Rollins.
Oh my gosh, that's amazing. That's amazing.
So that got, you know, the next night I went in and I played harder and you know, I just opened up and bashed on him, and he wrote another letter back and said, Dear Roy, thank you, sincerely, Sonny Rollins.
That's amazing.
But that kind of opened me up to saying, you know, the way I play, the stroke, the intensity, you know, it's that kind of opened me up to doing the field that I do now, you know, and then playing with him and playing all those kind of things. So, you know, if I come in and even from a long time ago, I come in and to my studio or to wherever I come in and practice, I just sit down and play time and try to develop that, you know. And I try to develop it on the bandstand, too. You know, I was always thinking about the time, the feel that I had, those kind of things, and thinking about those guys that were before me, you know. And it all helped to develop my sound, you know, and feel, you know.
Did you ever think about any method or way of communicating, like, real specifically to guys that haven't been able to play with those guys? Because, you know, I mean, it's not everybody gets to play with those guys. So.
Yeah, you know, that's funny, guys, because guys ask me at school, how do you get that beat? It's so hard to explain.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, but it is. Hard to explain. I mean, it's just a natural feel that I have, and I never broke it down into, you know, they said, well, can you dissect it for me? No, I can't. It's just a feel that I have, you know? So, you know, I show them what I do, and I tell them what I did.
Right.
You know, and hopefully they can come up with something that's similar. But I think that all of us went through some of the same things. I was talking to Lewis Hayes and, you know, guys like that, and they said, man, we all play similar, and there's only a few of us left now that play that way, you know? And I think we all went through that same kind of process,
right.
Jimmy Cobb, all those guys, you know? So, you know what? I can't really sit down and say, well, it's Tang, this is play it this way, or it's a, you know, it's just the notes are spaced this way. It's hard to tell you. It's just the way I feel it. You know.
Right.
Yeah.
I think maybe could it be the product of an era or the product of a region.
I think it's the product of an era.
Yeah.
You know, and the era I came through was, that's how it was going.
Right.
That's what's going on.
And just like by osmosis, you absorb that vocabulary and it just...
Exactly. And developed it from playing, because I was playing steady all the time.
Right.
Yeah.
That seems to be a difficult situation for drummers now. So you can't really play like steady all the time.
Yeah, it's not the same situation. You know, we played from week to week to week to week, and it was gigs for 2-3 weeks at one place, you know.
Right.
And we work our way across country and back, you know.
Right.
But we were playing all the time, almost every night, except for when we were traveling.
Right. Yeah, that's a whole other ball game when you're playing.
Yeah.
That
so
much.
And it gets you to develop a consistency of playing all the time,
right.
The same way or the right way, you know.
Well, just one technical thing that you told me a long time ago, this is for all the guys.
Yeah.
You told me when I was a kid that really helped me in jazz, you know, because I wanted to play jazz, I didn't have a clue.
Yeah.
But the first thing you taught me is to make that drive, you know, or to keep a groove, to make it groove somehow, mm-hmm. was the ride and this.
And the hi-hat.
Yeah.
And the hi-hat. That is very important. If you listen to all the major drummers, Max, all those kind of guys, you'll hear that hi-hat laying in there, you know? And I kind of play off that hi-hat. So if you play enough, you ride and you're locking your cymbal into this hi-hat, it's gonna swing, you know?
It's got to swing, at least.
You know, it's just... Now, you can vary the hi-hat and play it in different places and things, but you want to keep that groove going most of the time.
It's at an internal, it becomes an internal thing,
eventually. Exactly.
Yeah, I think that really helps. I mean, that's one of the biggest issues I see, like, with drummers that... maybe in Europe or in places that not having been born in the kind of the jazz culture, let's say, that there's kind of this soft groove. It doesn't drive like you know,
just with the intensity and stuff.
Yeah.
And that kind of locks in, it locks the time and you know, the time, whatever time field you're in, it's gonna keep it in place, I believe. You know, if you have that steady thing going here with the hi-hat and the ride, you know. Now you can dance around and play a lot of things, which I do. I just don't play chanka chanka. You know, you play a lot of different things, so it's
right. Yeah. That's very important. That vocabulary on the cymbal is what kind of makes it really move forward.
Exactly. So it's important for me for the swing.
Right.
You know. So if I study or or teach guys out of the books and things, it always says, like, play tang 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 tang,
right,
and you play everything around that,
right,
and you never vary tang tang tang. It's always that. So, but I mean, it's good to do that because it gives you independence
and right,
stuff
right.
like that, and it locks you in. You know, you can go do anything. Your independence is there. But on an actual playing situation, I would never play
right.
that all the time.
Right, right,
you know,
right.
Because I like to switch around.
Right, but, right, right.
So,
that's pretty awesome. And can you maybe, if possible, any kind of description that you can come up with about that phrasing up there? Because it's being like, it's becoming more rare, you know, to get it well, from the source.
Well, I don't know. I'll just show you.
Okay.
You
okay.
Know, I'll show you what I do.
All right.
Sorry, I had to put my earphone.
It's okay.
So, you know, it's just locking in. It's kind of a loping like feel,
right? You know, right, right.
And I think that I think it all develops from listening to a whole bunch of these different guys and then trying to and feeling right. and putting it together like that. You know,
that's kind of like way harder than what we're doing now, because you don't really can't see it like written down. Now you know this whole method I developed on the side and. Nothing exactly new, but I just developed it a lot more. It's the three-bar cycle.
Yeah.
The three-bar cycle is the rhythmic melody, let's say, that mm-hmm. all that vocabulary is based on.
Yes, yeah, but it's coming up.
But to get it like just from listening, that's not easy, right?
Well, because when I was coming up, you know, trying to play jazz and play blues and all those kind of things, we didn't have music schools.
Right, right.
There was no music schools. And so my friend Warren, who was an alto saxophone player, every night after we came home from school, we just listened to music.
Right, right.
After
right.
homework, music. And so right, our folks say, listen, you guys got to go to bed. Warren, you got to go home. You know?
Right.
You know? So we do that. But doing that every night and going back trying to play that and then trying to play those same things with little small groups and things that we developed, you know, mm-hmm. and it was invaluable for us,
right,
you know,
right.
because we had no school to go through. We had teachers, but they were like teachers who worked in music stores and
right,
stuff
right,
and weren't
right.
really professional musicians.
Right, 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 right.
You know, they were just guys who wanted... So we went to them, or they'd come to the house and they'd teach you how to play rudiments and
right, right.
things like that, but they didn't teach you how to play tang to spang a
lang. Right, right, right.
They didn't
right,
teach
right.
you that, you know. Mm. So we kind of developed all that on our own and it seemed to work. I mean, but, you
right.
know, by the time I was 16 years old, I was out there playing with, you know, some of the professional
right.
guys, you know, so. Now you have music schools, you can go to schools and things. I don't know, you know, they work, they're putting out a lot of musicians left and right all the time.
Yeah.
You know.
But they don't, it's strange because nobody really, like, gets into the depth of that vocabulary. It's
yeah.
strange. They're like... It's like you say, there's all this independent stuff, but the connection, like the rhythmic connection
yeah.
to that essential vocabulary, it's like, where is it? It's
yeah.
really bizarre.
Yeah, and a lot of students, I'm not talking about it's at the college where I teach, but a lot of students that I teach privately,
mm.
it's so hard to get them to listen to stuff.
Yeah.
You know, you say, they want to say, well, how do you get that feel? How do you get this feel? How do you get the... Well, you got to practice it, that's fine,
mm-hmm.
but you also got to listen to
right.
records and things.
Right,
listen
right.
to recordings and things. So I'll say, what did you listen to this week? Well, I didn't get a chance to really listen to anything, man. Right. But if you want to play this, you got to listen all right. the time. It's, you know, it's a lot of this. It's like 50, 60% you got to listen to a lot of stuff.
You think that the art of listening is like going away? Like intense listening?
Maybe intense listening. I'm not sure. I know the kids that I have at USC where I'm teaching, they do listen to a lot of stuff, and they'll turn you on to a lot of stuff,
right,
too,
right.
And a lot of the new guys, which is really nice yeah. stuff. So, but I think that intense listening has to start young.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
It has to start
interesting.
Young, you know?
I remember in the clubs, people would be sitting there listening to music with their eyes closed, literally,
yeah.
and you know, yeah. and listening to the music. I don't know what that was.
Yeah. Well, because you want to have. You know, it's one thing to play the drums and play the cymbal beat and everything, but you want to play it with the feeling of jazz, the feeling that comes along with this music.
Right.
You know, it's like you can play a rudiment straight, parrot or whatever you can play, but if you don't change it to the feeling of it's going to be just straight,
right.
like a military thing.
Right,
you know?
Right,
so
right.
You want it to be like, a feeling of jazz, you change the feeling, you change the accents, you change the different things.
Right.
So, in order to do that, you're going to have to, you can learn all the technique in the world, but if you don't learn the feeling.
Right.
You know.
The feeling would be that rolling kind of.
Yes,
the
and how to play it.
Yeah.
And listening to what other guys play and see how the feeling was. But,
man, that's invaluable information. Thank you for that. So, just slightly another thing. When you were on the road, can you tell us a little bit about what it was like?
It was great. I had a great time on the road, you know, because, I was playing with just the best people all the time, you know, so it was like a learning experience the whole time.
Right.
That was going to school.
Right.
That was really going to school. But, you know, when I first started out on the road with the Jazz Ted, Art Farmer, and Benny Golson, and then are you talking about how we traveled and all that kind of stuff?
Just how you felt, you know, what was it like to experience that whole...
Yeah, it was great because we got to play in a lot of the major clubs. We got to play in front of... I got to play in front of this beautiful audience and
right.
some great people, especially when you played in New York and played in places like Birdland and everything, and you know, in Philadelphia. If you went to Philadelphia, that was another experience. It seemed like the people in Philadelphia were so hip and they knew so much about jazz that if you weren't playing anything, they'd let you know.
Right.
But that experience was invaluable for my playing experience. From playing every night of the week, playing with these different giant musicians, it was an invaluable experience. You know, we traveled by car, then later on we traveled by plane, you know? So
right.
It was a great, went all over the world, you know, playing with different people, so it was...
And you said back in those times you'd have like 2 weeks in a row or something place?
Yeah, we would start out in... Well, you know, it depended on what the group was, but it really got intense when I joined Cannon. When I joined Sonny Rollins.
Okay.
So we would travel from city to city, and each place we would go would be either a week, 2 weeks, or 3 weeks in one place.
Wow,
you know?
Amazing.
And then,
nowadays, to have that is a luxury.
Yeah. Well, even when I was playing, even with Sonny... We were playing the places in New York, like the Five Spot, and we would be in there for a month
wow.
and a half, you
that's
know,
so
in the
great.
Same spot,
right?
Night, you know, and then with Cannon, it was the same way. We would start off, and I was living in Teaneck, New Jersey. We start out in New Jersey, in New York. We travel all the way across country, playing all these clubs. One week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks.
Uh-huh.
Go to the next club. 2 weeks, 3 weeks.
Amazing.
Next club be 2 weeks. We go all the way across country, all the way to California, all the way up to Vancouver.
Wow.
Into Canada. Come all the way back.
Right.
Playing
all the way back.
All the way back, you know. get back home, we'd be gone for, you know, a few months.
Right.
You
know? Right. Right.
Come back home, rest up. We stay home and hang out for a week or two, and then we, you know, and then we go out again. You know,
right.
But they put a schedule, and maybe this time you go to Europe,
right?
And then maybe, or next time you go to Asia. You know, and
amazing.
So you were working all the time.
Yeah.
And that was, with Canon, it was 11 years of that.
Wow.
You know. And then
11 years on the road, constantly traveling.
Constantly traveling.
It's interesting.
But that wasn't the shortest.
Oh, yeah? Oh, my God. Yeah. Who was longer than that?
Nancy Wilson. I was with Nancy for 31 years.
Oh, my God.
So we traveled for 31 years together.
Wow, man. Yeah,
from 1980 to 2011.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
What would you say, because, you know, it is an issue for a lot of people, like to be away from home or just to travel in general. People are afraid,
yeah,
like to travel. What's any advice you can give, like, students to prepare themselves for that, for the life, you know, of a drummer?
Well, I don't really know if it's the same now, you know, because the way we traveled is much different than
way more.
Yeah, because now when we go out, guys, I go out, when younger kids go out, I'm sure, unless they're with an organized group, they go out and do a concert, two or three concerts, and they're right back home.
Right.
Again, you know, so it's not a long period of time, you know.
Yeah.
Unless they're with an organized group that's, you know, maybe going to Japan or Europe and spending a couple of weeks there and coming back. But just playing around the States, I think it's a much different thing.
Right, yeah.
So, you know, the preparation for that is probably much easier than it was from when I was, you know. And I had a family, too, so we had to...
Intense.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I know what it's like. I mean, sometimes, because I travel a lot, a lot too, and I get a lot of questions like, man, don't you feel like, you know, another hotel room or you're, you know.
Yeah, you feel that sometimes. I'm sure you do, you know. You want to be home sometimes, maybe instead of being on the road, you know. But you have to have a bass, and I had a really great bass. My wife is incredible.
Right,
so she was with me, behind me the whole way of whatever I was doing. So if I was going out to play for a month or so, it was cool with her, you know. When you got back, it was crazy.
Yeah,
but she knew that's what I did, and she was proud of that. So, you know, she encouraged me to, you know.
That's great.
Instead of bringing you down, a lot of people will bring you down.
Right.
Say, well, man, don't you think you want to do something else? I've gone through that too.
Right.
But not with my wife, you know.
Right.
You know? So we had that based on my kids and stuff, and they were all, you know, they all grew up with the music, and they were proud of it too. So it happened like that.
That's so important to hear. It may not seem like important to hear, but we have lots of guys on the site from India and from places like that where there's so many traditions of, you know, family, and you're not supposed to, like, you know, live like that. That's such a strange thing.
Yeah.
But for a musician, it's normal, especially, you know.
Yeah. Then they ask you, well... Where do you live? You have one place that you live?
Right.
Yeah, I have a house. I own a house, right, you know. Right. And, you know, we own property and stuff like that. And it's cool. We live like it's like normal, but we just do it a different way.
Right. That's great.
Yeah.
That's good advice.
Yeah.
So there's one more thing I want. That's always one more thing. It's never going to end. I want to get as much information as I can. You were talking about more technical stuff, you know, drumming stuff, like the balance.
Yeah.
Like I, you know, have so many things that I learned from Roy that I learned from you. So it's just inculcated in the way I play now. So the balance issue is a big issue for a lot of people, especially at the beginning. So maybe you can talk a little bit about, we were talking about about it the other day, how you balance on your legs and your...
Yeah, you know, I tell, you know, it's very, I was, first of all, the teacher that I had, my first rudimental teacher, he was a teacher named Bill Street,
uh-huh.
and from Eastman School of Music. And I used to go over there through all through high school and stuff and study rudimental drumming with him and stuff like that. But he would always say, when you sit down and play drums, make sure you just sit down and have your arms fall naturally. Just the drums like this. And you know, you don't want to be down here, or you don't want to be up here. You just want to be a natural place. And he taught me to play from the wrist. So I played from the wrist. But the other thing was, then I found out that you have to, when you're playing the sub drum set, you have to have a balance. You know, you have to have good posture. You know, so you can breathe when you play. You know, and I play on my toes, and some, and my toe here with my bass drum, and sometimes with flat foot on with my bass drum. But I try to find a balance on the seat. Where I'm really comfortable. So I sometimes I'm not sitting on the whole seat. I might just be on a part of the seat. But it's, it helps me with my balance. You know, so I can sit up and play straight. You know, I don't have, a lot of guys you see playing, because their balance is off, they'll be playing their hi-hat and they'll be rocking like this. You know, or they'll be rocking because, or they'll be sideways or something. Because their balance is not right. So I always stress, sit up straight, get, make sure your drums are, your, the way you set up is in a perfect position so you can reach everything, your balance is cool, and that's it, you're gone from there, you know? It should be a, just a natural thing to sit down and, you know, and play with ease. The other thing I talk about, that I tell them is, you gotta breathe when you play. They think the drummers don't breathe, but they breathe, you have to breathe when you play, you know? So I love to play like in phrases and breathe in between. So if I play, like eight bars, so that little pause playing there is a breathing point for me. Are places where you can breathe, you know, just breathe. And so it's not going to be all running in together.
You know,
so you breathe with the phrasing. The phrasing.
That's very interesting concept. That is something that people ask about a lot. I'm glad you brought it up.
So that's phrasing. So that kind of thing. That along with the balance, sitting behind the drums, the way I play on the, if you play on your toe, for me, playing on my hi-hat with my toe, or with my bass drum with my toe, or flat foot, is, it all has to do with my balance of the way I sit behind the drums and play.
That's awesome. Cool. cool.
I try to switch some guys. I try to switch because I see a lot of guys playing
flat-footed.
Flat foot, you know. And, you know, I try to switch them, and, but, you know, then I think, well, if that's the way it works for them and they're comfortable, then fine. That's what it would do. You know? Same as match grip and traditional grip. You know?
It is physically limiting though if you if you play flat footed.
Because for me, I think for playing tempos and
I was just gonna say for high tempos, it's gonna be really
for high tempos playing figures with and just getting that just the normal. From the hi-hat, that sound that you want to get, you know? Instead of, you want to, you know, that
thing. I agree. He taught me that.
You know, and things like that. So, you know, I work on those kind of things. I still sit down every day and come in here and play time and just play time.
Stuff
and just, you know, try to keep things together.
Right. You know.